of MMTC, I'd like to extend congratulations to this evening's honorees. And so first of all, I'd like to welcome back our FCC Commissioner, the Honorable Mignon Clyburn, to introduce our highest honor, the Everett C. Parker Lifetime Achievement Award, to a man who shares not only her passion for social justice and serving the underserved, but he also shares her name. So, Commissioner Clyburn.
Thanks, Ms. Coley. She gave me credit for sharing his name. I guess I do. Good evening again, everyone. If you were to poll the current approximately 60,000 or so of our nation's reporters, correspondents, and broadcast news analysts, chances are great that they are unfamiliar with the life and legacy of Dr. Everett C. Parker. They take for granted, along with millions of viewers and listeners, that the relative press freedoms and robust engagement we currently enjoy today in media evolved naturally over time. But we are assembled here this evening because we don't make such assumptions. And we know that dedicated advocates, activists, and defenders of the public interest, like Dr. Parker, fought hard to ensure that all voices were represented and heard over our nation's broadcast stations. He is credited with the founding of the Office of Communications of the United Church of Christ, or UCC, and served as its director for almost 30 years. In the 1960s, Dr. Parker led the UCC's successful challenge of the license of WLBT-TV in Jackson, Mississippi, where the voices of Americans fighting for civil rights in our nations were shut out. His work to challenge WLBT-TV's license through the commission, the FCC, where I currently serve, established a precedent in which the public could have standing to challenge a broadcast license if it did not serve the public interest. To this day, at the young age of 99, Dr. Parker remains a staunch advocate for equal representation and opportunity in the media. His work has been guided by key fundamental principles: that diversity in media helps to challenge the status quo, ushers in new ideas and viewpoints, and transforms our communities into more tolerant, more inclusive, and most importantly, more fair places to live. Since 1995, MMTC has conferred its highest honor, the Everett C. Parker Lifetime Achievement Award, on those whose works bear semblance to Dr. Parker's. And it is with pride and privilege tonight that I am able to join you in bestowing the Everett C. Parker Lifetime Achievement Award on someone whose work, lifetime work and purpose, epitomize the very definition of public servant. This year's awardee is someone I know pretty well, who has fought tirelessly for the rights of the underserved. He believes in the promises of our digital economy and closing the digital divide. He has proudly represented the 6th District of South Carolina in the U.S. House for 19 years, is that correct? He would say something if I were not correct. Served as the House Majority Whip for 4 years, and is currently the Assistant Democratic Leader in the 112th Congress. The former high school history teacher, advisor to governors, state human rights commissioner, is not only a passionate advocate for civil rights, an unapologetic supporter for policies that promote equal access to health care and education. He not only is an advocate for curbing the laws that restrict Americans the right to vote, he is a person who unselfishly shares his wisdom and support to those of us with similar purpose and similar visions. By accident or design, my friends, today is celebrated around the world as International Nelson Mandela Day, So on this glorious day in which we celebrate the birth of that great international leader, a day in which all nations inspire individuals to take action to help change the world for the better, I am proud to present the 2012 Everett C. Parker Lifetime Achievement Award to a person who needs no introduction, but to a person who means the world to me and to you, I trust, Congressman James E. Clyburn.
Thank you. Thank you very, very much. Thank you, Mignon. I am so pleased to get this award, and it means so much more to have you present it. And I'm also pleased that you didn't tell everything you know about me this evening. Let me thank you for bestowing this upon me, and I apologize for holding the program up a little bit. I left the hill, I thought, in plenty enough time to get here, except that I usually am being driven around by Yeverton Watkins, who many of you know, who knows Washington real well. I don't know Washington that well, and it just so happens that Craig, who is driving with me tonight, is from Columbia, South Carolina also. So we had some real difficulty navigating the traffic. But it reminds me very forcefully of the difference of being in the majority and being in the minority. Because a couple of years ago, I would not have had any problem. The trip would have been advanced, and I would have had ways to get through the traffic that would have gotten me here on time. But we're going to take care of all of that come November. I started out with an early breakfast this morning, and I told the story of a story that my dad told me when I was growing up. My dad was an interesting guy. He was a minister who really would teach by parables and examples. And when he wanted us to really remember something, he would have something, some real forceful way of doing it. And of course, when I left home to go away to South Carolina State, I thought that I would be there for 4 years and would follow him into the ministry, as we had discussed so many times. But I kept sitting around Julia, and I waiting on the call. I never heard it. I'm not going to say that I wasn't called to the ministry. I'm saying I never heard the call to the ministry. So I decided around my junior year, after getting out of jail for about the third or fourth time, doing the sit-ins, of course, please don't. I've been told that I should always finish that thought because people might get the wrong idea. So I decided to go home and tell him that I had changed my mind. Now, those of you who may be familiar with South Carolina, you will know that Orangeburg is only about an hour, and if you're doing the speed limit, 10 or 15 minutes from where I grew up in Sumter. But on this particular day, it took me about 3 hours to take the trip because I was very, very anxious about telling him, thinking that I would disappoint him. When I got home and built up enough nerve to go into the house, I found him in the backyard weeding some vegetables. I walked up to him and told him of my decision. He looked at me for a few seconds, felt like 30 minutes, And he finally said these words to me. "Well, son," he said, "I suspect the world would much rather see a sermon than to hear one." I took that as a mantra, and I brought that here to Washington with me. And as I go about my duties and responsibilities, trying to represent the congressional district that I am voted upon, by which I'm voted upon, and the interests that you have here in this room, I try to do it in such a way that the world will see a good and productive sermon in all of my work. I happen to have trained, and I say that advisedly, rather than to have been educated, trained myself as a historian. I still study our history very forcefully. And I am here tonight to say to you that if you are not familiar with that period of our history, that 20 years from 1876 to 1896 that came right after the 10 years of what Lerone Bennett called Black Power USA, when our forebears were adequately represented in our government. Things happened in 1876 that are very reminiscent to what is happening to us today. And I want to say that those of you in the media, you are going to have a big job over the next few weeks and months, because I believe this is a watershed year. And I believe to the extent to which the public is informed will determine how well they perform come November 6th. And so I want to thank you for this award. I happen to have met Mr. Parker, and I am very familiar with a lot of his work in the 70s and 80s. He didn't challenge just one license. He challenged others as well. And I want us to think about him and his work as we carry out our own duties and responsibilities in the next few weeks, and think about what impact our work can have upon the future of this great nation of ours. Thank you so much for this award, and I hope that the good Lord allows me to live long enough to prove myself deserving of it. Thank you so much.
That was another milestone in MMTC's history. And I don't, thank you. Another one of MMTC's milestones. Let's give Congressman Clyburn another hand. And Commissioner Clyburn, thank you so much for, these are very important people, so syncing their schedules was not the easiest thing in the world. So thank you to both of you for being able to be here at the right place at the right time. Our next award, okay, now our next award, first of all, in the program it says we'll have our Corporate Diversity Leadership Award, which is being conferred to AT&T, but that will happen tomorrow at the lunch, so keep that in mind. Our next in the meantime, I'd like to introduce MMTC's, or reintroduce MMTC's president and co-founder, David Honig, to join us at the podium to introduce our first Hall of Fame inductee of the evening. So David, come forward.
Most of us who've been here a number of years remember why we started the MMTC Hall of Fame. We want to commemorate our heroes in media and telecom by cementing their legacy permanently. Previous year's inductees have included Everett Parker, Andrew Jackson, Marie Johns, Mark Morial, Johnny Cochran, Kathy Hughes, and our chair, Julia Johnson, to name a few. All of our inductees have demonstrated passion, ingenuity, and blazed their own unique trails in their careers in life. Our first inductee follows in their footsteps. David Grain is a highly respected telecom industry entrepreneur whose long list of accomplishments belie his youth. Believe me, he's way younger than I am. David owns the private equity firm Grain Management LLC, which makes investments in the wireless communication sector, including towers, spectrum, and backhaul for both commercial and government systems. Grain Management's flagship fund, the Grain Infrastructure Fund, manages capital on behalf of institutional investors, including academic endowments and foundations. David has also served as president of Global Signal, one of the largest independent wireless communications tower companies in North America, from its emergence from bankruptcy through its operational turnaround. Under David's leadership, Global Signal grew its portfolio from about 2,000 towers to more than 11,000 communication sites in all 50 states, Canada, and the United Kingdom. He's also served as senior vice president of AT&T Broadband's New England region, the third largest cable cluster in the United States, spent more than a decade in financial services at Morgan Stanley, focusing on telecom, media, and technology companies. I read all this, said, what an impressive list of accomplishments. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming David Grain to be inducted into the MMTC Hall of Fame.
Thank you, David. The last time I got invited to do something by David and Julia Johnson, it was actually a ruse. It was supposed to be a Digital Pathways conference in Palm Beach that turned out actually to be a surprise 50th birthday party for me. So I looked at this with a little bit of suspicion, but agreed to come anyway this time. So I want to thank David for all the work that he does, the MMTC board, all the staff, and all the people that support it. It was interesting, obviously I feel privileged to be honored the same night that Congressman Clyburn is. When I first met Congressman Clyburn, through whom it was really through Julia Johnson, we were sort of talking about politics, and he actually told me that I needed to read Black Power USA by Lerone Bennett from Mississippi, so he just talked about that and I did, and it was really eye-opening. Since then, and I'm a voracious reader, there's another book that I just finished called Big Bets. And it's really about how electricity was spread through the South after Reconstruction and the impact it had on revitalizing the economic prospects of the South. And as I was reading this book, you could substitute in the word broadband for electricity and it tells the same story. So the opportunity I think that we face, particularly as people of color, to participate in this massive growth that we're going to see in the wireless communications market is unprecedented. And I really applaud David, Julia, and the rest of the MMTC organization for what they're doing. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Jacqueline Clary. I am one of the fellows with MMTC. And I have the privilege of welcoming Congressman Cedric Richmond from Louisiana to the podium to induct Senator Sharon Weston-Broome into MMTC's Hall of Fame.
Thank you for that. And I want you to know that a few times you give out an award, but it's very rare that you actually get to give out an award to someone who you've worked with in the state legislature, who took the time to mentor you when you came in at 26 years old and kind of thought you knew it all and was really kind of out there And then to have someone that was very seasoned and dedicated to take you under their wing and make sure they nurtured you to get you somewhere. I don't know if I've been promoted or demoted in this group that I'm running with now. But I thank you for that anyway, Sharon. But let me just tell you a little bit about Sharon Weston-Broome. She is a person, and I can tell you from her background that she is several firsts, which it shows you the remarkable spirit and dedication that she has. She was elected Speaker Pro Tem in the Louisiana House of Representatives, and then she went on to the Louisiana Senate, where she was elected President Pro Tem. So she has served as the number two person in both the Louisiana House and the Louisiana Senate. And before that, she spent time on Baton Rouge's city and Metro Council. So she is a lifetime public servant that is dedicated to a number of causes, but two of which that are very important, one of which is children and families, and the family support system and network has been her true passion. And as president of NOBEL, she has gone on further to get into telecommunications and the importance of broadband to her first cause, which is children and families in the support network, and making sure that we can lift families out of poverty and make sure that we keep the family unit together. So her life before politics had a little bit of media and telecom to it, but recently she teamed up with the National Foundation of Women Legislators to produce a report titled Winning the Future, a Policy Framework for Empowering Women with Broadband. NOBEL has also passed a resolution that encouraged government, industry, and individual efforts to identify and leverage opportunities to increase home broadband adoption. So with that, it gives me a great honor to present the award and induct into the Hall of Fame someone that I look up to, someone who is of uncompromising value and such a role model to all the women in Louisiana, Sharon Weston-Broome. Oh, congratulations. We're gonna take a picture first.
First of all, I'm extremely excited and delighted and thankful that my congressman could be here tonight to present me this award. It means a lot to me that he would take out his time to come over. I didn't really give him a whole lot of advance notice. I kind of told him, I'm going to be there, and you know, I'd love for you to come. And he came because he's a responsive young man. He's an up-and-coming leader who's going to definitely make his mark. He's already started making his mark on Washington, D.C., but I certainly believe that the best is yet to come for Cedric Richmond. So I thank you so much, Cedric, for presenting me this award. I also want to take this opportunity to thank David Honig, as well as Maurita and Julia, for their support in helping to encourage NOBEL women to take on this cause of technology and telecommunications. Congressman Richmond is right. When they came to me, it was very easy for me to embrace the topic because my background, I'm one of the few legislators that's not an attorney. My background is in communications, my bachelor's and master's degree, so I embraced the issue very easily and certainly saw, more importantly, the value of embracing this issue and making a difference for families and children. And that is what NOBEL Women has been doing since we took on this issue. In fact, this morning we had a very, very hearty discussion, roundtable discussion on the value of telemedicine, which we understand and know will certainly help empower underserved communities, whether they be urban or rural communities. And so now NOBEL Women has stepped up to the plate, and we have advanced legislation in many states, most recently in the state of Maryland with Senator Catherine Pugh. But we are, congratulations. But we are extremely committed to making sure that people throughout the states understand the value of telemedicine to the people that we serve. And so certainly NOBEL Women will be the voice to carry that message. Lastly, I want to thank the NOBEL Women who are here with me tonight. You know, no one does anything alone. I'm a firm believer that teamwork makes the dream work. And I'm just the quarterback on this particular team. And so I want to thank those who have joined me, Representative Karen Camper from Tennessee. Senator Catherine Pugh from Maryland, who is here. Senator Ruth Hassel Thompson from New York, who's over there. Representative Earlene Parman from North Carolina. And Representative Vanessa Lowry Brown from Pennsylvania. So we have a good representation. In closing, let me say this. One of my roles is to serve as an adjunct instructor at Southern University in the Mass Comm department. And so when I heard the award that was given tonight, certainly to Congressman Clyburn, I was really delighted, and I had a big smile on my face, because one of the advocacy lessons that I teach my students is about WLBT and encouraging 21st century African Americans to make sure that they don't allow the continuous advancement of stereotypical images of African Americans in media, and that they become advocates in their own rights. So I certainly applaud all the rest of the honorees. And in closing, I thank God for this. I realized a long time ago that nothing I do has anything to do about Sharon Weston-Broome, but it always has to do about giving back to people. And so God bless each and every one of you, and thank you so much for this award.